types of designs. When we do experiments, there are a couple different designs that we need to talk about. There are two primary types of designs that we'll be addressing here. And the first we refer to as being what's known as a controlled experiment. And the second is what we refer to as an observational study. One's an experiment and the other is a study. And there's actually a difference between those. In a controlled experiment, the experimenter controls or manipulates the environment, then records the results. Control experiments are typically broken down into two major groups. We have the experimental group that's often referred to as the treatment group, and we have the control group. Now, as an example, in a medical study, we control the environment, we manipulate it by determining who gets how much of a drug. That's what I mean by controlling and manipulating the environment. Suppose you're making potato chips and you want to produce them faster without sacrificing taste. Well, if you make them too fast, you're going to burn them and they're not going to taste good. So you may be manipulating the environment in that you're increasing the temperature a little bit, but to help compensate for the burnt taste, you may be adding more salt or what have you. Obviously, I'm making this up as I go along, but you get the idea. That's what we mean by manipulating the environment. It's not manipulating the environment to get a specific result that you set out to get. It's manipulating the environment in a scientific way and then recording what happens. Now, going back to this idea of the experimental group and the control group. The experimental group, referred to commonly as a treatment group, this may be in a medical study the group that is getting the drug to see how the drug works. But we want to compare it to something. And that's what we commonly use the idea of a control group for. This group of people could be either getting a placebo, and we'll talk about placebo in just a moment, or they may not be getting any drug at all. Just to see what's going on. Or it could be a matter that we have a new treatment and the control group consists of the old treatment. The whole idea here is to take this group, compare it to this group, and hopefully tell us if whatever it is that we're testing is working or not, or if it's any better than the old. Now, very commonly in medical studies, we do what's known as a blind experiment. In a blind experiment, the test subjects do not know if they're getting the real drug or a placebo. And here comes that term placebo again. A placebo is a neutral or something that's inert that resembles a treatment but has no effect. Resembles meaning it looks like. So if the treatment is some type of purple pill, then the placebo will probably also be a purple pill. It's going to appear to be the same, so that if somebody in the placebo group gets contact with somebody in the treatment group, they're not comparing notes and trying to figure out who's getting the real thing. The whole idea behind the placebo is, the whole idea behind the blind experiment is to avoid what's known as the placebo effect. Now, the whole idea behind the placebo effect is, as an example, suppose that we all are in a study, we all have cancer, terminal cancer, and we're in a study where part of the people in the study are getting a placebo and part of the people are getting the real drug. Well, if you have terminal cancer and it's your last hope for life, you're going to naturally start feeling better. Well, typically, not everybody. That is the placebo effect. It doesn't really matter about the drug. You could be getting a placebo and all of a sudden, wow, you're feeling good and you're reporting yourself being better. Well, guess what? In a blind experiment where we have the control group getting a placebo, say a placebo is here, and the treatment group is getting the real drug, well, in a blind experiment, they don't know which is which. They don't know if they're getting the drug or the placebo. So the placebo effect, the feeling good just because you think you're getting something good, should be equal across the board. So the blind experiment helps to cancel out the effect of the placebo, so to speak. Now, placebos are not sugar pills. Typically, when you talk to somebody that understands placebos, they say, well, it's a sugar pill. No, it's not. I guess it could be in one particular example, but more likely, a placebo, something truly inert. It could be just distilled water. I mean, truly inert. You wouldn't give sugar pills as a placebo when somebody's involved in a, say, diabetes study, as an example. So the idea of a sugar pill, if that's what you're thinking, get rid of that idea and think of something neutral, something inert, like I said, distilled water or something like that. In addition to blind experiments, we also have what's commonly referred to as a double blind experiment. In a double blind experiment, neither the test subject knows if the experimenter is measuring nor the experimenter. Neither the test subject or the experimenter actually knows whether the person is getting the real drug or they're getting the placebo. And the idea here is help to prevent or to reduce human nature. If you know that somebody is getting the real drug, you may, and you're taking measurements, you may be prone to unknowingly bias the result by reporting better than actual results. So in a double-blind experiment, it helps protect against that sort of a thing. If I'm taking measurements from somebody in a study and I don't know if they're getting the real treatment or not, then how can I possibly bias the results, like I said, knowingly or not? A prospective study is a study of future events, meaning that persons enter the study, say, today, and they're followed into the future. And actually, we all don't have to enter today. I could enter the study today if I were a test subject. You could enter it 2 weeks from now, maybe 2 years from now. But the point is that you enter at a certain date, or the subjects enter on certain dates, and then they're followed into the future, recording information as they go along. A prospective study, because it's dealing with future events, very commonly students think that we're trying to predict the future. No, we're not trying to predict the future. We're trying to figure out maybe if this particular drug works better or not. Now, here's an example of a controlled experiment that was, in fact, a prospective study. It's the aspirin and heart attacks example. Now, the following information was actually taken from research completed by the Physicians Health Study Research Group at Harvard Medical School. The Physicians Health Study was a 5-year study testing whether regular usage of aspirin reduces mortality from cardiovascular disease. Every day, physicians participating in this study took one aspirin tablet or a placebo. The study was a blind experiment, so the people taking the measurements knew who was getting what, but the people taking the drugs didn't. In this case, an aspirin or the placebo. Of the over 11,000 physicians taking the placebo, 189 experienced myocardial infarction, they had heart attacks, whereas only 104 of the 11,000 plus that were taking aspirin had a heart attack. Now, based on the results, it can be shown that persons taking the placebo were approximately 1.83 times more likely to suffer a heart attack. And we'll learn later how to calculate this 1.83, where that actually came from. Now, this was a prospective study. They followed people for 5 years. And this is actually the site for it if you wanted to actually do a little research and look it up yourself. Now, I'm sure you've heard the claim that taking aspirin helps reduce heart attacks. Well, this is part of the reason why. It was because of this study. Now, an observational study, subjects self-assign themselves to groups. We don't manipulate the environment. And the key here is that data already exists. You're simply going out to get it. You may be pulling data out of medical records. By self-assigning to groups, let's just say that we're looking at the effect of smoking. Well, we're not going to grab 100 people, tell these 50 people, you smoke 10 packs of cigarettes a day, you don't smoke at all, so let's see what happens in 10 years. That would be a controlled experiment, but you don't do that. So the person assigns themselves to their own group, and that they decided whether they're going to smoke. So that's how they assign themselves to the group. You don't call them in and say, what group do you want to be in? It's already done by their action. They're self-assigned as a result of their actions. Opinion polls, medical records are very, very common examples. Because in medical records, you may go back into everybody that had a particular disease, look at their records and look for, you know, characteristics that were common. Observational studies are typically either retrospective or cross-sectional. It's kind of hard for me to imagine a prospective observational study. Typically, prospective studies are controlled experiments. Now, a retrospective study studies the past events. That's what I mean when I talk about going in and looking at past medical records as an example. Persons are identified who have experienced the event that we're interested in. Maybe they have a disease, so we're going to look at their medical records and look for things out of the ordinary that they share. The history of the case is simply then traced, and the data is pre-existing. It's already there. It's already in the medical record, so we're just going to go out and get it. That's the basic idea there. Now, in a cross-sectional study, the cross-sectional study is a study of events at the current time. That's one point in time. Data represents what's going on at that cross-section of time. The most common example are opinion or political polls. In an upcoming presidential election, you're always hearing about the results of this person's poll, that person's poll, and they're all opinion polls, and they call it X amount of people, and they ask them, you know, who you're going to vote for. If the election happened today, basically, who would you vote for? Who you favor? That's cross-sectional. It's what's happening right now. We could easily turn this into a perspective if we keep calling back the same people and record the result each time and then compare that to current events. Maybe a politician made a speech. Did that speech have an effect? Well, you call these folks back and then say, hey, you know, did you change your mind? Sort of that sort of a thing. And then you could continue the prospective study if you check with them periodically and say, well, is your opinion still the same or has it changed? How long lasting is the effect of that speech? That we could think of as a prospective study. But your typical opinion poll or political poll, call people today and see what their opinion is of the candidate, that's definitely cross-sectional.